thanks for being here. What I want to talk about today and sort of whack through it, but it's fairly basic stuff that I talk to all of my coaching clients all the time. And it's very specific. It's dealing with how to not just prepare for an interview or a meeting, but how to really crush it. And I find that most people will say to me, Mark, you know, I don't understand why I didn't get that job, or I don't understand why I didn't do well in that meeting. I'm the best candidate, or, you know, I was fully prepared. And a lot of times when people think about preparation, what they think is that it means to sort of either read a company's website or a brochure, or maybe look at someone's profile or something like that. But from my perspective, the best way to prepare for a meeting or an interview is, well, there's really going to be three steps. I'm going to go through those real quickly. So we'll start first with an interview. If you are about to go on an interview in the next couple of days, and it doesn't matter what company it is, but for argument's sake, I'll say it's a bank, or investment bank, let's say it's Morgan Stanley, and you're interviewing to be an equity analyst in their forest products area. I don't know, making that one up too. But let's say you're going to be doing that. Well, the best way to prepare for the interview is not necessarily to, again, look at Morgan Stanley and their team and their mission and all that kind of stuff, but it's going to be actually to anticipate what it is that the hiring manager specifically wants. Because at the end of the day, the interview process is a process of elimination. That's all it is. It's kind of like that Survivor TV show that used to be around, where all you need to do is survive the process to the next round. That's it. Keep on going to the next round until you're the final person that they extend the offer to. That's it. You don't need to be the brightest, the dumbest, the fattest, the skinniest, the whatever it is, doesn't matter. You just need to survive to the next round. So the best way to do that is to anticipate everything that that hiring manager or the person interviewing you is going to be looking for and what do they want to hear. So for example, you're going to be interviewing with this hiring manager or the team lead for that position in the forest products area of Morgan Stanley's equity analysis division. So what I would be doing is, first off, making a list on a yellow pad of paper of everything that you think that person would be looking for in the ideal candidate. Not you, not somebody else, but the ideal candidate. So for example, he or she may be thinking, well, number one, I want someone with experience. So I want someone who's got knowledge in the forest products area. Number two, I want someone who's going to be personable and sort of good to work with. Number three, I'm going to want someone who's very strong on the analytics side of things. Number four, I'm going to want someone who's a team player who can work well with others, whether it's in a project setting or independently, but it's critical that they all mesh well. Number five, it might be somebody who just sounds like they know their stuff. They're very confident in their knowledge. And number six, I really want somebody who's got a positive, upbeat attitude. I don't want the person draining, but I want someone who's, what do they say, raising the level of all ships. So I'm going to be making a list of all the things that I think the hiring manager is going to look for in the ideal candidate, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, whatever it is. Now, I might not have as a candidate all 5 or 6 or 7 of those. I may only have 3 or 4. That doesn't matter. I want you to fully prepare for what that person is looking for. Because if there's something that you happen to lack, for example, let's say you don't have much experience in the forestry industry. It's okay, because then you can say, well, geez, you know, over the years, I've developed expertise in mining. But mining is very similar to forestry because A, B, C, D, E. And I can leverage my expertise and my connections in that space towards connections in the forestry space. And then I can understand better what it means to be a top company in that industry. So if you anticipate all the things that that person's looking for, then I want you to do is to think to yourself, if I'm that hiring manager, how am I going to ask the candidates? Let's say there's 10 candidates. How am I going to ask them all if they have those things? Well, I might ask you, hey, are you a team player? And Matt's going to say, yeah, I'm a team player. I played on a team. Of course I'm a team player. And yeah, but everyone's going to say they're a team player. But no, that's not going to work for me. So I need to hear an example of how you're a team player, an example of how you perhaps pulled the rest of the team together and led them to greater success, whether it's completing a project under budget and under time, or if it was leading them in sort of taking over another company or you know, finishing something else, whatever it is. If you've got specific examples of how you brought together a team and acted as part of a, like an integral part of a team, that's what they want to hear. Okay. So I want you to, number one, anticipate everything that the hiring manager is going to look for. Number two, make a list of questions that you would ask the candidate, all the candidates, if you're looking for all those things. And then number three, please write down the answers that you think would resonate the strongest with that manager. So the reason I want you to write them down is you're going to be much more inclined to keep it brief, keep it to the point, and keep it on sort of on task on that answer if you're writing it down. If you just say, yeah, I know that I'm a big team player, so I got this covered. The problem is you're going to go into too much detail and you're going to bore the living crap out of the person you're talking to. It happens every time. We think we're going to keep our answers brief, but when we're in a scenario that we're a little bit nervous and we're not sure how we're performing in that interview, we tend to talk more. People talk more when they're nervous. And one of the things I always like to tell people is that at the end of the day, people like other people who listen to them instead of talking to them. And I know you all know that. So that's the first critical step of preparing for the interview, is anticipating everything that the hiring manager is going to look for. And then from there, really focusing on, anticipating the questions that they'll ask and then coming up with some great answers for that. All right, that's the first step. Second step, step two, is anticipate any holes you have in your background. And there may be lots of them, maybe very few, but anticipate those. Go ahead and grab your resume if you've got one and look throughout it and say, oh yeah, you know what? I didn't work for 8 months. They're going to ask me about that. Or, oh yeah, I had 4 jobs in 4 years. They're probably going to ask me about that. Or I bailed on my MBA after 3 semesters. They're probably going to ask me about that. Or, I got canned from my last job. They're probably going to ask me about that. Write down all the things that if you were interviewing yourself, how would you put that person on the defensive? What questions would you ask them to make them be like, oh no, he asked me that, darn. We all have things that we really don't want to talk about when we go into an interview. There's things that we're hoping they kind of forget about. Well, you've got to be ready for those and you've got to be ready to address them. But the way I do that is I use something I call the PNP method of answering. Big capital P for positive, a little N for negative, and then a capital P again for positive, PNP. And what that means is when you get a question that's designed to basically put you on a defensive and maybe knock you out of the running, because again, as a hiring manager, if I'm interviewing 10 people, I'm only going to hire one. So I got to get rid of 9, at least 9. I may end up getting rid of all 10. But if I get rid of 9 and I have one, I need to knock those people out of the running somehow. And maybe, 3 or 4 of them, I just don't like them or something. Maybe 3 or 4 of them clearly don't have the right experience. But I've got to figure out how to knock some people out. So I'm going to likely ask questions that are designed to do that, that are, I have concerns about something in their background. So I might say, hey, Julie, I see that you've got, 4 jobs in the last 4 years. Should I be worried that this is going to be your 5th job in 5 years? Then you're going to leave me after a year. Well, that's an absolutely valid question to ask. Now, do I care as the hiring manager if she's had 4 jobs in 4 years? No, I don't really care. That's the past. But I do care if it's relevant going forward. I do care if it is going to be the 5th job in 5 years. I want her to come here and stay for ideally 3, 4, 5 years, not 1 year. So I'm going to ask that. Or I might ask, Sam, hey, Sam, I see that you left your grad school after 1 year. You just couldn't hack it? What happened? Did you quit because it was just getting too hard? I mean, I'm curious about that. Now, it may turn out that Sam ran out of money or he had a family issue or who knows what, but I want to find that out. It's really important to me to make sure that I'm hiring somebody who I can rely on completely and who's going to stay through the difficult times. So there's going to be something in your background that people are going to want to know more about to see if it's going to impact how you work at their company going forward. So with all that said, if you make a list of all the things on that same, in that same, yellow pad of paper, of the things that you would ask yourself if you were going to try to knock yourself out of the running, and then write down the answers to those questions. And when I said earlier, PMP method of positive, negative, positive, I want you to answer it in a way that leaves the person asking satisfied that they're confident with you as a selection. So if it was something where it was 4 jobs in 4 years, and I said, Mark, I see that you've had 4 jobs in the last 4 years. Is there a big reason for that? I'm going to start off with a big positive statement, big positive, capital P. And I'm going to say each of those opportunities was absolutely fantastic because each one of them really contributed a solid foundation of knowledge to me to be able to bring into your company here. Every one of them offered something that was unique and different that stood out, that really added to my growth, that allowed me to be able to come here. And even though in two of the cases, they basically went out of business. One of them was downsizing and I was caught up in that. And one of them, I just got a great opportunity to go to the next firm. So there are valid reasons for each, but they've all led to the point where I can come to a company like yours. And after a substantial amount of research and really trying to be as selective as possible, this is the reason why I'm here, because I'm anxious and excited to bring that expertise I developed with those 4 other companies into your firm here. Now, most people will remember that first P and that last P, the positive, positive, and they won't necessarily focus as much on that little negative that's in the middle that says, well, two of them I left because of this, one left because whatever it is. They're going to focus on the fact that you're leveraging and bringing those 4 experiences into their company. So PNP, there may be another situation where they say, well, I see that you got, your end date was, in June this year for so-and-so company. You know, what happened? Did you get fired? Did they not like you? What's going on with that, right? Well, I would say, actually, my tenure there was fantastic. The people were great. The work was amazing. And I made so many great connections. It was really a great opportunity. It was a great place to be. And even though as a result of, the COVID and they had to make some layoffs and they had to save some costs and I was caught up in that a little bit, I'm absolutely thrilled because now it's giving me the opportunity to really dedicate myself full time to finding the job that I really want to be in, the job that I think I can truly come into, contribute right away and crush. And that's exactly why I'm here today, really bringing that expertise that I developed at my previous firm, and I'm coming here. So again, PNP, focus on that. So again, with this second section, the second step, make a list of all the questions that could throw you off your game and make sure you have answers for those. But again, I sort of went long-winded, but try your best to keep them a little bit shorter and to the point. But again, try to do the positive, negative, positive. Don't do that on every single answer because it'll be pretty obvious that you're doing that. But if you get a couple that are throwing you off a little bit, make sure you use that format. But the only way to do that is if you prepare for those in advance. Don't have it scripted out because then it'll be pretty obvious. But I think you know your experience and what's gone on with you. So make sure that you sort of have it, that you're comfortable with that answer. All right. Third step. And this is possibly the biggest and most important one. When they ask you, do you have any questions for me? Do you have any questions? Well, most people have either, this is their response, either, no, I think you covered everything, bad. Or, yeah, you know, I was just wondering what's the vacation policy here, bad. Or, you know, I'm just curious, you know, what's the day-to-day responsibilities here? Okay, but not great. What you want to do is ask a question outside of the interview box, outside of it. What I mean by that is, most people are asking questions that tie in with the job or tie in with the company a little bit, that sort of thing. What I want you to do is to engage the person in a conversation and get them to talk. The best way to do that is to ask them a question about something they happen to know a lot about. So in this case here, I'm going to ask this person from Morgan Stanley, I'm going to ask him probably a question or her about forestry and equity analysis in there. Okay. So and best of all, I'm going to ask their opinion. The big reason I do that is that if you walk into a bar and you listen to people speaking with each other, it's usually conversations that go like this. that guy's an idiot because, or this woman's a jerk because, or whatever it is, or the Yankees suck because, or, you know, the Patriots, whatever it is, because. And people give their own opinions. I don't think you've ever heard anybody say, so Bob, tell me, what's your impressions of the Yankees pitching staff this year? No, they say Yankees suck or Yankees are great or whatever it is. So it's human nature to offer up your own opinion. It's against human nature to ask someone else their opinion. It really is. But in an interview, you will score mega points, if you ask their opinion, because they'd be thrilled to show off how much they know. So with that said, if you were to ask, for example, if you said, so Sue, you know, I've noticed that in Europe, a lot of the hardwoods in the forestry area, a lot of those are being sort of, there's a you know, less supply of those that are coming in to be made into pulp paper. And so I see with the supply going down, obviously demand's going up. Is that, you know, is that something that you think is going to continue over the next few years? Is that something that's tied in with global warming or something? What is your impression of why that's happening? Well, suddenly she's saying, oh my God, number one, this guy's actually paying attention to the news and what's going on in Europe regarding the, you know, whatever it is, different types of trees and so forth. And then he, best of all, asked me my opinion and what I thought. So she's going to answer, well, actually, I think in 2 or 3 years, I think the supply will start going up again because they're, you know, it looks like the reports are that the drought really had an impact on how much they were able to harvest this year, whatever it is. But next year, it's going to start rebounding. But while she's answering that, she's saying, you know what? I really like this guy. I really like this woman because they're asking me my opinion. They pay attention to the industry. I really like this person. And that's what you want to do. You want to make that impact in the interview where they look at you and say, wow, I like this person. I want this person to be working on my team because they care about what I say as a manager and what I think and what my opinions are. I don't want to hire that person who might be have a Harvard MBA or whatever heck it is, but who all they care about is their own opinions. I don't really care about their opinions. I'm hiring you to work for me. I don't want to hear your stuff, right? So that's why, to me, the most effective questions in an interview are the ones that generate the other person's opinions, a conversation, and it turns it from an interview to a conversation. Once you get to the point where it's no longer, you know, hiring manager asking candidate questions and then the candidate answering them and then going from there, instead now it's, hey, you know, let's talk about the industry. Let's talk about stuff. One of the things that I remember, I was absolutely terrified, and this is going back a long time ago, and some of you know about this, but I, you know, I graduated from Colgate University. When I went first visited the campus, they were interviewing the prospective students, and I was terrified. I thought they were going to ask me about Shakespeare or about just stuff I didn't know anything about, and I was like, oh my God, I'm screwed. But I got in there, and we just started talking for a couple minutes. But then the guy found out from me that I, at the time, I mean, he was a big Mets fan, so we talked baseball for a while, and he was also a big classic rock fan, and we talked about the Beatles for a while. We talked about the Mets and the Beatles. That's it. Not much else. And I think that that's what got me into the school. I mean, it wasn't my grades necessarily and so forth. So I think I was too amped up and I was worried so much about what I didn't know about. And then at the end of the day, he just wanted to ask questions about just shooting the shit. But we talked about, you know, our opinions on things, and it was a conversation and not an interview. So just to recap all the stuff here, the three critical steps. Number one, again, anticipate that you are the hiring manager. What are the things that he or she is going to look for? Make a list of all those things. How are they going to find that out? Make a list of the questions they would ask. And then third is to really craft your answers that really answer those questions fully and to their satisfaction. So the second part is going to be to anticipate all the questions that they're going to ask you to put you on the defensive, to knock you off your game. And anticipate those, prepare for them, and try to craft your answers in a PNP format that really, honestly, make it seem like it wasn't a big deal after all. And then third is to really come up with 2 or 3 questions in advance that of your meetings with people where they say afterwards, wow, that was incredible. I'm so happy that person asked me those questions. I really like that candidate. He or she is my number one choice. So those are the 3 steps right there to prepare.